Well, thanks everybody for coming out tonight, and you know, your time's precious, and we recognise that, so we want to make the best use of this time together. Okay, we'll start by praying. Father, we just thank you. We're coming into your presence, and we recognise that there's something being built that is beyond us, that is not of man, not of the will of the flesh, but is of you, and our heart's desire is to be part of that which is birthed of you. So we commit this evening to you, Lord, in this time together. Father, I ask that you touch each one of our hearts in Jesus' name. Praise God. Amen. Okay, so these times together, once a month, it's part of the Wednesday night pattern whereby on a 4-week cycle, we'll have 1 week, we'll have a house of peace, one in Leeds, one in Bradford, and the vision is to expand those. The second week, we'll have a house of peace leaders time with the leaders of the house of peace, which at the moment is Johnny Georgie, Lanre Moshi, and Fiona and myself will go to them. Then the week after, we'd have a house of peace, and then the week after that we'll have this time, which is house of peace leaders plus, well, we felt the name like encouragers, like kind of trainee leaders, but like encouragers. So if you think what is that role, what is that, it's people who are like, you're like the kind of like the spiritual glue, okay, in this ministry, in this church, to, You know, the Bible talks about the bond of the Spirit, that what God's forming here, that as people own the vision in their heart and get the Holy Spirit's burden, they become like the glue of the Holy Spirit, which helps to develop and grow the ministry in terms of relationships that are in the Spirit, and helping to bring new people in, and helping new people get joined and attached, and helping the houses of peace develop, helping the church develop. And what we want to do is train and equip, so from this kind of group comes the next house of peace leaders, and the house of peace leaders themselves within your houses of peace can be also, that's a place for helping to develop and bring people on, because we don't want a static vision that just stagnates where you kind of just in a cozy home group and it's like that forever. And yet it has to be family as well. It's not like driven, you know what I mean? Got it. But the Holy Spirit is a spirit of development, is a spirit of growth, is in rest, and the kingdom of God is a kingdom of expansion, isn't it? And walking with Jesus is always a challenge to grow and develop and expand and get out of the comfort zone. So this kind of vision is so that we can develop people, and it's going to be great, us going to Miami next week, because in a sense that's very obviously 20 years further down the line. They started with 12 people in 1996, and there's 20,000 or so in Miami, plus spread to other cities in the USA, and then a network of 250,000. And pretty good growth, isn't it? Mm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Pastor Trevor, when they took on their church, I don't know how long ago they took over on the church at Bethsaida Worship Center in Durban, but it was about 500 people. It wasn't doing very well. A lot of the finances were poor, the church was pretty poor, and it's more than doubled. And part of their vision, it's the fire of God, and it's also cell groups. Okay, basically this is a cell group vision. Okay, so if you've ever had any familiarity, has anyone heard much of the cell group type of thing? You know, cells multiply. And maybe in this day and age, calling something a cell group's not always the wisest thing. Okay, so churches can call them different things. We settled on the name House of Peace, so... So, okay, Father, help me share what needs to be shared, and keep an eye on the time and not go on too long. How are we doing? 8:05. Right, well, I wanted to start tonight just looking at some things. Now, I can email these notes out later, but it's good just if you want to take notes, that's really helpful, and you can reflect back on them. Kind of like first things first, what kind of DNA do we need as trainee leaders in this church? Obviously, like within any kind of vision, there can only be one vision. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 1 to speak the same thing, have the same mind, have basically let there be no division amongst you. Division is differences of vision. Okay, so I've always said that, and anyone in leadership would say that basically when we're in a church, when God puts us in a ministry, there's always going to be things where we might differ on, it's not quite our cup of tea, but our hearts should be able to be in the thing wholeheartedly. You know, there's churches out there that aren't my vision, and it would be wrong of me to be part of them and kind of like be there to try and change it. Or, well, I shared at the last conference we had some people from another church that we're going to take the fire back to our church, and I understand that sentiment and can honor it, but there's also a point of hold on a second. If the senior leadership of your church don't have this vision and you're trying to, actually you're in rebellion. And so I've always said to people like that, if the best thing is to be on good terms and honor and just move on and bless them. But if we're in a house, it's where we can, this is the vision, and this is what we put our heart and ourselves into. And everyone has a different DNA, different flavors. And as we come into a house and kind of leave our vision and get into the vision, then in the mix, everything works out. And we reach our potential, because at the end of the day, the Christian life is not about, it's not really about self-fulfillment. It's not. It's actually, and I say this before God, it's about self-denial. And I don't mean that in some kind of harsh, kind of Catholic, you know, but it's about losing our life and we gain our life. And so the most satisfied people are actually, God puts a vision in them, and in the process of self-denial and serving a vision, they reach their potential and they're fruitful and they're who they are in God, they're in their service to God, and we become then what we're meant to be, whether it's in the fivefold ministry or whether it's in any of the other gifts and ministries that are listed in 1 Corinthians 12, there's gifts, ministries and offices. We become that and we're fulfilled in that, because if we try and be something that we're not, we don't have the grace for it. Okay? So that's the stuff that it's we know, but it just always needs saying. Now, one of the things I want to talk about DNA, is about having solid scriptural foundation. Some of the things we'll share tonight, it's kind of stuff like we might already know, but as I pray, this is what God put on my heart. Okay, I'm going to say this. This might sound like a mouthful. As a ministry, God calls us to have a solid, reformed, evangelical understanding of gospel truth. A reformed, evangelical understanding of gospel truth. And this isn't just about names and splitting hairs over terminology so we can go, oh, we're reformed, we're evangelical. And there's a lot of churches out there, reformed and evangelical, that are as dry as toast. There's no life whatsoever. But we need the Word and the Spirit. A lot of the modern church that's very Word of Faith or Grace or Revival, Charismatic, Supernatural, and as you know, we love miracles, doesn't have a strong foundation in a reformed evangelical truth of the gospel. And what does that mean, like a reformed evangelical? It's basically the truths that were birthed at the Reformation around that period. And it was an imperfect time. There was all kinds of politics at play. Read the Bible, you can see it all through church history, you can see it in Israel. But nevertheless, God sovereignly was working at that time, bringing truths of the gospel. And we'll look at some of those tonight. And, you know, we're in the last days. And so we need to be founded on solid truth. As people live in the gospel, there's a lot of benefits to the gospel, isn't there? There's truths that in the atonement, Jesus, though he were rich, for our sake became poor, that we through his poverty might become rich. Okay? That doesn't necessarily mean we're going to have a yacht and be millionaires, but we're going to have our needs met. In the atonement is healing, and there's all kinds of things to the atonement that are benefits. Okay? But at the core of the gospel is righteousness. And it's the fact that people are made right with God. And in the gospel, there's healing for our heart. Jesus said, come to me all who are weary and heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. And there's all these benefits to the gospel. But the core of the gospel is righteousness. And so the modern church uses the benefits as a carrot stick. And obviously Jesus met people where they were at and ministered to them. But one of the core things about the gospel is it says God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. Okay? And I would say in the UK today that we need that kind of wisdom. Anyway, we need to have an appreciation and a reverence for the scope of Scripture. Okay? Not snapshots. Now, if I mention names of famous ministers, I'm not saying these people are bad. Not at all. Okay, but for many modern Christians, their Christianity is a Joyce Meyer Christianity, or a Brian Houston Christianity, or a Joel Osteen Christianity, or a T.D. Jakes Christianity, or, I could go on, and a Bethel Christianity, a Walmart Christianity, a Kenneth Copeland Christianity, a Maldonado Christianity. Do you know what I mean? It's all like brands. And that's much of the modern church, because people don't actually read the Bible. They don't read it. They get snapshots of it. And so in all of those ministries, there can be great things, but they're human beings. And so we need to treat the Bible. We need the whole scope of Scripture. Okay, that's why I've been plugging so much about, it sounds obvious, read the Bible, but just spending time, I'd give anyone a challenge, read the whole book of Hebrews in one sitting, and don't worry too much about trying to understand and pull apart every doctrine. Let it read you. Okay, just tomorrow morning read all of 1 Thessalonians. There's only 5 chapters, you can do it in 25 minutes. Read things as much as you can in context. Listen to it. Get and on this next point, I want to really, as a training exercise, I'd like you all to get a copy of this. This is a Bible commentary on the book of Romans by John Stott. It's called The Message of Romans by John Stott. There it is on Kindle. After the Bible, this is probably the greatest thing I've ever read. Okay. The Message of Romans by John Stott. A good Bible commentary doesn't necessarily force too much of the opinion of the commentator, although obviously it needs to be sound, but rather gets you to really get into the text. And I love this series. The Bible Speaks Today series is really good, and John Stott's stuff in this series is excellent. It's not too highbrow academic, kind of like all head and no heart at all. It's accessible, it's challenging, but it's accessible. I know every person in this room, you could get a lot out of it. And just spend this year, get the book of Romans in you. It will absolutely transform your life. Rather than just having, you'll hear people say, it's the goodness of God leads people to repentance. And then you'll get people preach stuff off the back of that and this kind of woolly flakiness. Actually, if you look in the context of it, the goodness of God is God delaying his wrath and judgment. If you actually look in the context of the whole passage, it's a very, there's loads of things when you actually understand letters in context, that's not saying I think, well, I'm not called to preach or teach, that's fine. What it will build into you is such a solidity in your own soul. Much of the Christian material is very therapy based, okay? It's very therapy based because it does sell books, okay? And Christian media and publishing is worth a lot of money, especially in the, and where we're going next week in the United States, it's worth up to billions probably. And we kind of like, we look for magic keys in the latest book and the latest ministry and the latest this. Actually, we've got that. And just by letting it read us, you know, the Word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword. It divides between spirit and soul. The Bible counsels you. It's not like you have to think, well, I'm depressed. Where do I look for depression? Just read the thing. And make it part of our life, and it reads us, and it divides between that which is soulish and heals our emotions. It's not the dead letter, it's the living word, because it's the word and the spirit. And quite often I don't feel like engaging with it. It's a bit like I hear people say, well, I'm not really into reading my Bible, I'll kind of listen to it, or I'll listen to a CD. Well, it's kind of like when you're young, like, well, I don't like vegetables, I don't like greens. And it's kind of, I remember my mum saying, yes, you do. I'm glad she made me like them. It's, yes, you do, because there's times I think, oh, I feel rusty, but it's like once you start eating vegetables, you realize you want them more. And we have to be people of the Word of God in this day and age, because I tell you, there's so many people sliding off into error. Sorry to say, I mentioned some famous names before, I'm not against anyone. I know some of those people are sliding towards acceptance of gay marriage. Okay? So, yeah. Right, I'll some recommended reading. Okay. Some old classics, yeah. I'm someone who, I love miracles, I love the supernatural, I love faith. I've probably can quote Kenneth Hagin better than Kenneth Hagin. Well, he's in heaven now. I've listened to probably hundreds of hours of Kenneth Copeland, you know, all that stuff. Love faith, love it, love it, love it, love all that stuff. There is areas of it where it's a bit, some of it, but on the whole, yeah. But without a solid foundation in some of these Bible things, that stuff can be right, can take you right off, unless it's in context. So this is a classic, Bible Doctrine by Wayne Grudem. Absolutely awesome. The it's a smaller version of, there's a one called Systematic Theology. I've got a copy at home. It's like a wall brick. It's like two wall bricks. It's actually not complicated. There's just an awful lot to it. And but Bible Doctrine by Wayne Grudem, you don't get all these, just Lectures on Revival of Religion by Charles Finney. Because I want to share about the gospel soon. Okay, when these older guys back in the 1800s used the term religion, they didn't mean in a disparaging way like today, oh, you're religious. They just meant the Christian life. Lectures on Revival of Religion by Charles Finney. You can get it on Kindle for 99 pence. Anything by Finney is awesome. Finney was perhaps one of the greatest evangelists ever. In the modern gospel, and these are statistics from the USA, where they can get this stuff, where in they did researches some year in churches and where people have made decisions for the Lord and filled in cards for accepting Jesus, and something like 6 months later, 0.5% of those people are going on with God. 0.5. Finney, 20 years later, it was between 80% and 85% of people brought to the Lord under his ministry were going on with God. That is just phenomenal. And he taught in depth how to deal with souls, how to have wisdom with souls, and it's just good reading. He'd often teach things like every soul has windows of opportunity where the Spirit of God's working on them, and there's some light coming to them, especially when they get around church or Christians, but it doesn't necessarily mean they're yet converted. There's some reformation going on, but not yet transformation. But every soul has a limited number of windows, and when they hit the last one, it's gone, and their fate is sealed. He was a very serious guy, very serious guy, really totally committed to getting people saved. And he would talk about how sinners hide behind a bush, and you've got to beat their bush and get them out. You know, like, like shooting pheasants, you beat bushes. You've got to beat every bush and get the sinner out there, hide behind this, behind that, behind this. And using wisdom. He who wins souls is wise. Okay. Here's a good book, Foundations for Righteous Living by Derek Prince. It's a good one. It's based on Hebrews 6, which are the foundational doctrines of repentance from dead work, faith towards God, baptisms, laying on of hands, eternal judgment and resurrection of the dead. That's quite a thick book. Atonement by Derek Prince, that deals with the work of the cross, which includes healing, prosperity, freedom from curses, all that sort of stuff. But Derek Prince's style is very truthful, it's very sober. He was a man who believed, like I said, believed in healing and biblical prosperity. This is a great one, especially in this day and age. Can You Be Gay and Christian by Michael Brown. Excellent book, dealing with the whole subject of homosexuality in a very truthful but very compassionate manner. I believe Christians like ourselves are going to face persecution on this line in the future. And our choice is, are we going to sell out on Jesus Christ and please man, or are we going to please God? Another one by Michael Brown is Hyper Grace, which really, in a lot of wisdom and a lot of love, it's an incredibly gracious book, actually, very gracious, and it deals extremely maturely, a lot of grace, with most of the modern teaching in the church that is off balance. An excellent understanding of sanctification, just really, really good stuff. And the one I read a few years ago called The New Tolerance by Josh McDowell. And this is kind of Christian wisdom on political correctness and all that sort of thing. Okay. Right, so I mentioned Romans. Romans is kind of like, it's in the book of Romans, okay? You know the Bible's 66 books? If we understand this bit, there's Romans 1 to 16. Okay, if we understand that, basically we understand the whole thing. That is basically the key to the gospel, is that the book of Romans is the manifesto of the gospel. And we think, oh, but what about the four gospels? They show the life of Jesus. Okay, but Paul said, we no longer know him according to the flesh. And the book of Romans has more teaching on the gospel than anywhere else in scripture. The book of Galatians is a very condensed version of Romans, but Romans is far, far more detailed. And the book of Romans deals with every major doctrine of the Christian faith. Everything that the reformers got came from Romans. Martin Luther was on his knees on broken glass as a Roman Catholic monk, going up the steps on his knees on broken glass to make penance for his sins, when the scripture from Romans about the just shall live by faith, and he got up and walked away. I don't need this religion anymore. And so by understanding that, it's a key to understanding the scope of scripture. It's so, so awesome. So I'd really, really encourage you to get that. Okay. Praise God, where are we? Yeah, so basically, we're Glorify Our Church. We love the presence, we love the Spirit of God, we love the supernatural. And we're going to the most one of the most supernatural churches in the world next week. And I think that I haven't seen a lot of the messages lately, but had a few clips of some of Apostle Maldonado's teaching, and it seems quite serious at the moment. Very end times, very, you need to learn to live by faith because you're going to need it, kind of stuff. But they're seeing a lot of increase of the supernatural at the moment. Interesting as well, I had a dream a few weeks ago about receiving an impartation for supernatural evangelism whilst we're there, and it's the School of Supernatural Ministry, but the Tuesday night they're having a School of Supernatural Evangelism, so we will be there next Tuesday night, so that will be good. So yeah, so we love all that, absolutely, but like I said, having this foundation of scripture, I mean, do you know what, I got born again through the Bible. I didn't get led to the Lord. I got given a Gideon's New Testament in school, and all my friends threw theirs away, or they would write Damien Thorne 666 in the front of theirs. You know, the horror movie, the Omen. And I kept mine, and I used to read it when I was high and stoned, and I thought I wasn't going to wake up the next day. And I'd already read the New Testament cover to cover several times before getting saved, and I knew God was calling me, and I knew the conditions that were on my life to get saved. I knew exactly what I had to repent of, what I had to renounce, what I had to give up, that if I were to follow this God. And I used to try and make bargains with him all the time. I'd wait till I'm an old man. I was planning to join the forces at the time. I knew I couldn't do that because I couldn't be party to killing people, loads of things like that. And I just knew all this. I knew all this love of God being revealed into my life, but I knew all this conviction too. Wasn't an easy place to be. It's kind of like God wants to love you and give you all this life, but it's on his terms and you got to surrender. And I remember throwing mine away because I just wanted to rebel against God and go deep into sin, which I did. And then after hitting a low point in 1996 and hitting a crisis, I cried out to God. I knew the God of the Bible was the real God. And I was born again on the spot. I didn't really know the terminology. I just knew that I knew that I knew God. I didn't have a Bible. I was desperate for one. There wasn't an Amazon at the time. I couldn't get hold of a Bible. I used to go and sit in the Roman Catholic Cathedral and read the Bible and feel tempted to steal one, but I knew I couldn't do that. I never read like the Apocrypha or anything like that. I don't know, I just kept it. Weird though, isn't it? I remember I was sitting at home once and I went, God, I need a Bible. And in my mind's eye, I saw this bag in the attic underneath these boxes, and I just kind of, I saw the Bible inside. I thought, no harm, I'll go up in the attic, and it was just as I saw it. And I would start on a Monday at Matthew and be finished by the end of Revelation and through Psalms by Friday night, every week, again and again and again. I got saved through scripture, and it was alive to me, transformed my life. And then it was a couple of months later that I met church, and you just realize how many people have shed their blood throughout history, you know, especially since those Reformation times, that we might have the scriptures. Thousands of people have shed their blood, and there's people in the world today. I mean, even in Africa places, you might have one Bible in a church of hundreds, and they will give their right arm for one today, literally, or they'll get one and they'll cut it up into little pieces and pass it around. And so we've got to treasure God's word, and as we exalt wisdom, wisdom's going to exalt us, and all the blessings and all the benefits and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit's going to pour into our life. Amen. So I'm passionate about the Bible. Okay. Praise God. So I mentioned before from Proverbs 11:30 that they that win souls are wise. So whether we're an evangelist in the fivefold, whether we're particularly extrovert or not, you might not consider yourself an evangelist. Not everybody in the Second World War was a frontline infantry soldier, but everybody was part of the war effort. Everybody was conscious that we cannot lose this war, we have to win it. And so, you know, in other countries where there's more of a sense the church has to be alive, then there is a consciousness of that, and that's so when churches face pressure and persecution, they tend to win souls more because they're praying. And we've had it very, very easy in this country. But if we could, just by being faithful to the gospel in the coming years, we could face prison. Yeah. It's not just being, oh, I've seen some crazy YouTube videos and paranoid, oh, is Obama the Antichrist? Is Trump going to be the Antichrist? Is Cameron the Antichrist? Is all the royal family lizards? Hello, Your Majesty. Can I just take them? Crazy stuff out there. But really, just by being a Christian, already, you know, we people can lose their jobs, but we could fall foul of the law. So to live true for God, we need to know, obviously, for many in the church, the world has been a comfortable place, and it's a lifestyle. God's just your life coach, man, and it's a lifestyle enhancement kind of thing. So, but God calls us to be wise and win souls, and there's different styles to the gospel. Okay, so we're not going to, perhaps in the style that they would have ministered 100 years ago, but the message and the content, there's no deviation from it at all. There's nothing new. There's no new revelation at all in the Christian walk. And that's where people are getting eclectic and people are getting deceived. And we personally know people who are in all kinds of error, and it's so there's nothing new at all. And I say these things and I'm thinking, goodness me, I want to be positive and I don't want to go, but we're in the last days and there is a spirit of error. And so where those people are in 20 years time, amen, we're going to be still strong for Jesus. Okay, so there's no deviation on the message. And things that, you know, when Paul says, I've become all things to all men, the actual context of that was Paul denying himself. So that to the Jew he became a Jew, to the Gentile he became a Gentile. So he would literally deny his own dietary requirements so that he could reach people. It wasn't like, I'm becoming hip and cool or anything like that. I'm not saying it's wrong to become hip and cool to reach young people. If we kind of go along to the skate park with our King James Bible and just like Victorians, we're not going to get, but do you know what I mean? Everything becomes, we want to be relevant, but we can't change the message. And the message of the gospel is actually not really that relevant. You know, what is relevant to man is self-righteousness, his own works, his own goodness, his own merit, every religion on the planet, every ism, humanism, it's all about man and what man does. And the Bible just basically says, everything you think is good about you is a filthy rag. You've got nothing to bring to the table. Actually, what the Bible says about man is really, really bad. The Bible is actually quite shocking. When I say the Bible, it's like, the Bible is all we have in terms of our revelation for who God is. It's all we need. Yes, we have an actual tangible relationship with Him, but the God we have a relationship with is the God of Scripture. And if we have snapshot views of God and we come away from the God of Scripture, the God of Scripture, it's not like He used to be a bad God, but now He's had a PR makeover and He's nice Jesus. Hey, check out Jesus in the future. You know, it's the same God. You know, so, yeah. Okay, now some of the things to the gospel, I'm not going to touch on predestination tonight, but there is a God element to the gospel and there is a man element. Okay, there's the God element and the man element. So the man element is the person's response to the gospel and the people that are involved in preaching. Okay, so like I said, not going to go into predestination now. And people might hear that and write that off. Oh, predestination, that's horrible. How could God predestinate some people to be saved and others not to be saved? Because Scripture shows that. It does. You know, God raised up, it shows He's raised up some people to be the objects of His destruction. And if we don't have a scriptural view of God, we take man's side and we go, that's horrible. My God's not like that. Well, my God's not like that because I've actually made a God up to suit myself. No, we answer to him, he doesn't answer to us. Do you see, the Christian life is we have a scriptural view of God. Now I threw that one out, and people say, what about the scripture that says he desires all to be saved? So is that God's will? But God respects man's free will. There's two wills. The fact that God wants people to be saved, one will. The fact that God, in his will, respects people's will, there's two wills. Oops. So it's not just if God willed everyone to be saved, then that is kind of full stop at the end of that. Believe me, everyone would be saved. Because what God wants, he gets. He can turn the heart of a king. If he wants it, he's going to get it because he's God. He's God. And we're just... And this is why like faith teaching, and I love it, which is about authority. And there's no kind of like contradiction, because there's things held in tension. Faith teaching says, I'm in Christ. I'm sat at the right hand of the Father. I'm a son of God. I speak the mountains. I cast out demons. So almost like saying, people can get it. I'm operating like God. And in a sense, operating in miracles is operating like God. It is. Because you are like Jesus. You're not Jesus. We're not making that error. But at the same time, God is massive and transcendent. And we're just a spelk. And he does not answer to us. We answer to him. It actually says, who are you, O man? And so when we say, this is the God that chose me. Okay. Right. So let's look at some of the God end of it. We know that salvation is of God. It's not of man. Salvation belongs to God. John's Gospel says that we are born of God's will, not the will of flesh, not the will of man. Doesn't it? So, every one of us here born again, you weren't born of your will. Wasn't the will of flesh, wasn't the will of man, was the will of God. Bible says in Ephesians 2 that you were dead in your sin. So if any of us were to walk into a morgue and say to one of those dead bodies, come on, you should be alive now. It's dead. We were dead. We did not make ourselves alive at all. We haven't got that power. So salvation is of God. Making us alive is 100% an act of God. Regeneration is 100% an act of God. And this isn't a cold clinical thing, because people can approach this just with the mind. God, in his foreknowledge, predestined us. Okay? In his foreknowledge, what could say about that? But that tells me God has people in Leeds and Bradford, okay? Because he said it to Paul, didn't he? He says, look, you're having a tough time in Corinth, stay here, because I've got people here for you. Because God knew them. So we get into God's groove, if we get in the right groove, and we're not passive. And I remember years ago, and a guy who was a really hyper-Calvinist, not pretty. Okay, if you take this stuff, it's like you've got two ends of the spectrum here. And they were out and about, and a homeless guy was dying. And his friend said, oh, well, if he's not one of the elect. Well, that's awful, isn't it? That's just wicked, horrible. Okay, and so there's this God element to the gospel, and there is man's side as well, because man is 100% responsible to repent. How does that work out? You know? Some of us, say if you've been in situations and you've gone out and shared the gospel, and that person has been soundly converted. It's not just you've gone out and you've met somebody, you've met a friend at work, and that person, you've prayed for them and they've been soundly converted, and they're converted today. And you know, what happens if I hadn't met that person at that time, and this happened and that happened and this happened? It wouldn't have happened. Had I not prayed? Had I not given myself? And you can feel the human end of it. But at the same time, every little variable in the equation, God saw all and he's in control. Because at the end of the day, you were intimately involved with this person's salvation. You felt the human element of it. But you, being limited, could only, I bless you, be involved with that one. What about the other 20? What about the other 100 that you couldn't be? Yeah, it's like I've went in, you've heard my stories, I've been in cancer hospitals in Africa. Awesome, man. And you're there 2-3 hours and seeing whole wards of people gloriously healed of awful stuff. Like, they're dying. It's like, oh, 2 or 3 to a bed, and an hour later they're all rejoicing and leaping and they're all safe. Well, then you have to leave the hospital knowing there's another 10 wards of those people that you couldn't go to. And so there's this human side, but then God and all the variables and all the timings, He's in control. And we have to rest in that, because He's God. So yes, it says in Romans 8, 29 and 30, it says, for whom He foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom He predestined, these He also called. Underline called. Whom He called, these He also justified. Whom He justified, these He also glorified. This is why it's worth reading Romans this year. Okay. So, in the calling of God, there's what's called an effectual call of God, where God calls you and you know it. It's irresistible. Who remembers that? There's times you have the dealings with God and you know when the time come and God that summoned you, the King of the universe. Because we have this, if you don't have this big view of God, what you have is yin and yang. The devil and God are equal opposites. And so, like I said, I love faith teaching. I love miracles. I love casting out demons. I enjoy it. It's great. The disciples said, Lord, we saw the demons subject to us. And you think, oh, He's rebuking them, saying, oh, yeah, yeah. But rejoice, your names are written in the book of life. Oh, I rejoice, my name's written in the book of life. I enjoy seeing demons cast out. I enjoy seeing the sick healed. I like seeing my enemy get his butt kicked. Love all that. And, praise God. And yet, there's something about the greatness of God far, far above that. We can have this faith thing that almost makes, and to an extent, we are partakers of the divine nature. But taken too far is we become a God. Hold on, that's a bit. But there's the point where when God calls a person, that effectual call, and you lose, when you have that view, God and the devil are not equal opposites. You just, you know, and when you read the Bible, right? I read the whole book of Isaiah in 2 days last week. Awesome. And you realize all the stuff going on in the world today is just like a drop in the bucket to God. He's not even moved. He's just like on His throne like this. Because you see all the turmoil, the political turmoil that took place back then, nothing's changed. And God is not stressed. The nations are a drop in the bucket. The United States and all its power, and ISIS, and Europe falling apart, and what could happen in the next 20, 30 years, it's all a drop in the bucket. It's not even, it's now. It's completely insignificant, actually. And all God has to do is go, oi, come. And they're coming. He called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. No man called you out of darkness. God Himself summoned you. And not a devil in hell could stop that. And yet we intercede. It's all straight. It's things we hold in tension. We do intercede and we do pray. And we do take authority over the enemy. We preach the gospel. Angels don't preach the gospel. God doesn't preach the gospel. Unless Jesus shows up in the dreams of Muslims. It's all stuff we hold in tension. But we need this big view of God. And if we're going to have a sound New Testament view of the gospel, we need this. We need this because this gives me confidence. You know, even if Islam was to take over in 30 years' time, it could. The demographics now, just here I am, Bradford. I was thinking the demographics in Yorkshire, under fives, for the under fives, 5 years old and younger, what is the largest demographic in Yorkshire? Go on, answers on a postcard. It's Muslim. So what's that tell you about 15, 20 years time? It's, so what? I mean, yeah, when we get some, but it's all a drop in the bucket compared to the bigger picture. And so God calls people out of darkness into his marvelous light. But in the calling element, that's why I said underlying calling, God uses the foolishness of preaching. So let's look at some of the elements that make up the gospel without sounding like a formula, but these are elements. Okay, this is one of the reasons why we have to be a praying church, and a church that walks in the Spirit, so that we're co-laboring with Christ and we're not working in vain. If it's all about us and our efforts, we're just going to wear ourselves out. But at the same time, we're not going to adopt a fatalistic approach. Oh, God's sovereign, we do nothing. Because Paul said this, he says, I endure all things for the sake of the elect. He knew when he went to a town and city, he was going to be persecuted, he was going to be put in chains, he was going to be beaten, maybe half dead. But he knew there was an elect bunch of people in that city, and he was going to sweat it out for them. And through the preaching of the gospel, God was going to put out an effectual call and call some of them. Some of them people in that city would be called for. Wow. I'll tell you, in the past 30 years in the UK, church growth in the UK, African churches have grown. One of the few English church movements, indigenous English church movements, that are seeing growth. In some ways it's not really my cup of tea, I don't know, but they're great, is New Frontiers, which was started by Terry Virgo. And one of the reasons that they see growth is because they're grounded in this sort of stuff. Because they've got at the heart, not sure so much where they're at these days, but certainly when Terry Virgo started out, very, very grounded in biblical grace, in the gospel, very much in Romans as well. So there's a good example there. So we're going to labor with Christ, and then we're going to see people saved, who God, not man, is drawing. So if anyone's got their Bible, do you want to just shout out? I've been doing a lot of talking. John 6, verse 44. John 6, 44.
No man can come to me except the Father which has sent me draw him, and I will raise him up at the last day.
Amen. So it's a work of God, isn't it? How about this one? Acts 16, verses 13 and 14. Someone want to shout that one out? Acts 16, verses 13 and 14.
And on the Sabbath we went out of the city by a riverside, where prayer was wont to be made, and we sat down and spake unto the women which resorted thither. Is that right?
Yeah.
And a certain woman named Lydia, a seller of purple of the city of Thyatira, which worshipped God, heard us, whose heart the Lord opened, that she attended unto the kings, unto the things which were spoken of Paul.
So Paul went into that city knowing he was co-labouring with God. He went where the people gathered, he preached, God opened the heart, and she attended to what Paul was saying. Who wants to move in that? So we're not in anxiety, we're not in fear. Yes, we're praying. Yes, we're fasting. We're praying for our friends and for our relatives. And you know, we can hear this sort of stuff and we think, but I prayed and I fasted and I bound and I loosed and that person got saved and I prayed and fasted. Amen. But God in his sovereignty before he made the earth called you to be that intercessor. Amen. And all these variables, and is it all just faith? Is it all, is the and yet all through the Bible, man is still responsible. Jesus said to the Pharisees, he said, if you will turn, I will heal you. They're responsible for turning. And yet he also said that God had hardened their hearts. It's out of the mouth of Jesus. And you see, we live in time from beginning to end. God lives outside of time. So it's not fatalism. It's not. Because people, every person who receives Jesus Christ and has biblical faith, they are responsible to believe. And every person who rejects Christ and is lost is responsible for their lost condition. And yet God foreknew the whole thing. So let's look at some of the elements that make up the gospel. Got to keep an eye on the time. Romans 3:23 says, all people have sinned. Also in Romans. Romans 6:23 says, the penalty for sin is death. So people are responsible. Romans 5:8, Jesus Christ has died on the cross to pay the penalty for our sins. And Jesus Christ has rose again for our justification. Romans 4:25. People call it, you know, talk about the Roman road to salvation. Again, Romans. Right, so like I said, people must understand personally, must personally repent of sin and put their faith and their trust in Jesus. Now, a very famous passage of scriptures from John 3, verses 16 and 19. We know it. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Keep on reading. He who believes in him is not condemned, but he who does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son. And this is the condemnation, that the light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. You'll have people saying that the only thing that people aren't saved for is not believing in Jesus. Everything else is forgiven. But Jesus himself qualified the very reason why people willfully choose not to believe Jesus is because they love darkness. Because their deeds are evil. So at the heart of the gospel message, and if you study Romans, in this John Stott commentary, one of the things about John Stott's commentary, it's about 50 years ago, there was a man called Martin Lloyd-Jones who wrote a commentary series on Romans. It's about that long. And that one by John Stott's a bit of a compression of the whole thing. It's awesome. But there's a structure to Paul's letter. All of Paul's letters have structures. And the first Romans 1 through to around about verse 16 is kind of good news. And then it goes dark from Romans 1:18-ish. It goes really dark through to about Romans 3:10. It's pitch black darkness because what? And then it brings in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed. Romans 3:23, yeah. So there's a pattern where the Spirit of God through Paul basically discusses the gospel in a nutshell. In the gospel is salvation to the Jew first, then the Gentile, that bit. Then it goes, but the wrath of God is revealed from heaven in 1:18 to Romans 3:22. It's just purely talking about the wickedness and evil of human beings. And John Stott says it is as dark as hell. And it goes through every category of human sinner. It talks about depraved humanity, kind of like depraved Gentiles, where all you're teaching about the sin of homosexuality and perversions in there. Then in Romans 2, it talks about your different class of sinner, who are your moralists, which would have been like your Greek philosophers, and it condemns them outrightly. Then it goes on to talk about your Jewish class of sinners who are religious, and it condemns them outrightly. What Paul does by the Spirit of God in those passages is outrightly condemn every single class of human being, to bring absolute, like in a court of law, total conviction to every single class of person, to show beyond a measure of a doubt that all of us are wicked and falling short of God completely. You know, your throat is an open grave. poison of asps is under your lips. There's no one righteous, not one. And it's almost like when you read that, people have to come low and see that before they can be really converted. And it's not like we hear that, we think, oh, but my God's not like that. Or we get an image of a really rude person standing on the street screaming at people, telling them they're going to go to hell. And it's almost like the enemy can get people off balance and make them religious nuts. Okay, be really rude and obnoxious to actually, but in the love of God, if we're going to love God and love people, we've got to help people through that Roman road, because they can't be truly converted unless they've seen it. And like, I've heard people say, oh, but I just went to church and I had a simple message that Jesus loves me, and praise God, and I'm, here I am, I'm following Jesus. But for every case like that, there's 100 more that have fallen away. Because as soon as they've hit a trial, they've heard the life is good message, and the Christian life, there's loads of benefits, there's prosperity, there's healing, there's all of that, but who knows, there's actually gone through, who's been through literal hell as a Christian? I mean, as a Christian, you know, if you hadn't followed Jesus, life would have been easier. You wouldn't have had this conflict within and without and stuff. That's not the life is good message. And so if people are fed just the benefits, as soon as this stuff comes at them, they're out. They've fallen away. And for many, they're not converted. There's a false conversion taking place. And so in that absolute love and gentleness and meekness, and that's why he who wins souls is wise. An idiot could, a fool could get an understanding of some of this stuff and just go out there and just be incredibly rude and unloving to people, and that's not gonna win souls at all. But at the same time, we can just have a kind of a salesman benefit message. And you know what, most of the world just looks at that and just going, they just laugh at it. When Christians are trying to be cool, the world just thinks we're pathetic, really. The respect was more when we're actually real. I was in the shop the other day, and there was a song came on the radio. It's that Canby Stanton song, and the girl behind the counter is a normal 18-year-old girl. She just started like mockingly going, "Oh, praise the Lord, praise the Lord." And that's what people's, you know. And okay. So there's Jesus said the reason why people won't believe is because of sin. Charles Finney taught, you've got to deal with people's idols. So we need wisdom. We need wisdom. So there's people we love, you know what their pet idols are, don't you? You know what they are, and we need the wisdom of God to ferret those people out of those things. So we mentioned before, but Hebrews 6 talks about the elementary doctrines of Christ are foundations of repentance from dead works that lead to death. Person can't be saved without repentance. And the modern gospel, the modern church, there's no repentance in it. There's no repentance. Repentance from dead works and a faith towards God, of the doctrine of baptisms, of laying on of hands, of resurrection from the dead, and of eternal judgment. So Paul's saying, to make sound Christians, you've got to teach and impart into them a real sense of repentance, faith, inclusion into identity with Christ, baptisms, laying on of hands, receiving the Spirit, the fact that I'm going to be raised from the dead and there's an eternal judgment. It's pretty, this is the God of Scripture. And let's start how the Holy Spirit convicts of sin. And I've, over the years, I've kind of like, who said this? Oh, just let the Spirit of God touch them. Just leave it to the Holy Spirit. And with all honor for the Spirit, we've all had the dealings of the Spirit, but there's clear examples in Scripture. How does the Holy Spirit convict of sin through us? And so that sounds great, until that could put us in the coming years into some very, very uncomfortable situations. I am the vehicle of convicting these people, and they might not like it. I remember God saying to me once how, just about spiritual warfare, he says, I demonstrate my wisdom of the principalities and powers through the church. And that's why we don't like it, because it's like God uses us like a weapon to hit them, and we feel the hurt. It's like, imagine God gets you in a headlock like that and just uses you, bang, against them. Thanks God. But, you know, he's God. Okay. Right, let's look at some examples of how the Holy Spirit convicts people through us. So here's a great one. We all want this one. Acts chapter 2. Let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. When they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Now we have a friend called Dougie, who's from Newcastle, a real working class Geordie ex-football hooligan, who travels the world preaching. And I remember telling the story, he said years ago, he had this girlfriend and they were thinking about getting married, they didn't in the end. And she was from a really posh middle class background, really, really high class. And he said, in his very Geordie way, he says, I was around her having Christmas dinner. And they said, oh, Douglas, we hear you're a preacher of some sorts. And he went, all right. So what is your message? And he went, well, you've heard that Jesus died on the cross. Yes. Well, you put him there. And he just said, it just went. And Sue looked at him like. But the Spirit of God spoke for him. I had a friend in Preston, he says he was as red as anything. He was a full-on socialist communist atheist. And someone at work loved him enough to tell him he was a sinner and he was completely wrong. And he was furious at the guy, absolutely furious, and he got born again a few days later. So, yeah. So this is a wonderful example of preaching the gospel and the Holy Spirit bringing conviction. And the people responding very positively. Here's another one from Acts 7. When they heard these things, they were cut to the heart and they gnashed at him with their teeth. But he, being full of the Holy Spirit, gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God and said, look, I see the heavens open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. Then they cried out with a loud voice, stopped their ears and ran at him with one accord. And they cast him out of the city and stoned him. And the witnesses laid down their clothes at the feet of a young man named Saul. So there's the both examples, equally powerful anointed preaching. Okay, that brought intense conviction, probably equal on all of the hearers, but two different results. Yeah. Now, if that was today, that certainly the second one would be thrown out. It's not relevant, because it's not relevant to hear that. Actually, I'm a liar. What? Or, you know, God loves you, but it's your sin that separates you from God. You know, do you know the fact that people have so many emotional problems? The root of it's sin. It's their convictions, their conscience. You know, in Romans 2, 14 and 15, it shows how God's law is written on the conscience of every human being, and people get that badly wrong. They say, oh look, there's evidence that people can't be saved if they haven't heard the gospel, if they just obey what they know. No, the whole context of the whole thing is to show that every single human being, and you can see it in Romans 1, has enough light, enough revelation to hold them accountable. There's no one on planet Earth can say, well, I didn't know. Everyone knows at heart. And so what he's saying, Paul's saying, look, even Gentiles who do not have the knowledge of God, they do by nature fulfill some aspects of the law. So you'll get people unsaved who are just, you know, staying in a monogamous marriage for life, faithful, good parents, you know, integrity in business, good with money, don't cheat people, don't lie. But God, they're not saved before God because they know the law on their heart, they're obeying some of it. It shows that they've got it, but no one can be righteous before God in their own works. And God sees actually some of the other stuff that's there. So, praise God. So, the job of the church is to be an instrument of conviction. Obviously that means we've got to have our house right as well. In other nations, the church is an instrument of God's conviction to the world, and it should be. We're salt and light, and I believe we've got to get stronger in the Holy Ghost. We've got to get stronger in the Holy Ghost. Okay. Right, here's a good example. Acts 24:24-25. It says, after some days, when Felix came with his wife Drusilla, who was Jewish, he sent for Paul and heard him concerning the faith in Christ. Now, as he reasoned about righteousness, this is Paul. So this guy, who's some governor, and if you look at the background of it, this woman Drusilla, he pinched her off someone else. It's different to this other guy, but I did some background research. So these are kind of like, you know, in a funny position. He sends for Paul because he wants to hear the faith of Christ. So what does Paul preach to him on the faith of Christ? He preaches, he reasons with him. That means he's trying to reach the guy's conscience about righteousness, self-control, and judgment. So there's the apostle of grace. That's his gospel message to this guy. And Felix was afraid. He was convicted by the Spirit of God. So if the Holy Spirit's going to, if people are going to have this effectual calling of God, it might not happen there and then. You can see when Stephen brought it, an effectual call of God went out. But it wasn't like Peter. He didn't go home buzzing that night. He went to heaven. But young Saul was there. He got it. Now here, you see the guy getting convicted. And so there's an element of the gospel where the church has to step out. If we want to see the Spirit, if we want to get into God's program, and the Spirit is going to effectually call people through our ministry, we need a wisdom that's supernatural to reach them, more than just it's not like in our first encounter, we people talk about building relationships and building trust, but there's a risk to take. There's a risk to take here. With friends, with relatives, the risk to be seen as a bigot, all the rest of it. That's why I recommended the book, like How Can You Be Gay and Christian by Michael Brown. Just worth getting, worth reading. Okay, so he's reasoning. This is Paul's answer. This is Paul's gospel, and Felix is obviously convicted. This is, means the Holy Spirit approves of this message. It's not like Paul standing in the middle of Bradford with his big King James waving it at people and being rude and obnoxious. He's reasoning with the guy. He's getting on his level. So what is the content of Paul's gospel proclamation? It's about a real faith in Christ. Okay. You know, when you hear about, just believe in Jesus. People just need to believe in Jesus. Well, the devil believes. But the word believe, the word believe and the word faith are the same word in Greek, and they mean this. They mean to cling to be fully persuaded, and to have fidelity to. Fully persuaded, cling to, fidelity to. And it's like that story, the guy pushing the wheelbarrow over Niagara Falls on a trapeze wire. Is that right? No safety net. And there's a crowd watching him. He says, who believes I can push a man in this barrow? And everyone puts their hands up, and he points to one guy and says, get in. And he doesn't. So he didn't believe. And so biblical belief is a full putting the trust in, a full clinging to. Now, it can be like I heard a famous guy fudging it on the homosexual issue, and saying, well, you know, this secular, would you say it's a sin? Well, it's not my place to say what sin is, you know, and we all sin, and we all fall short of the glory of God, and we all mess up, and we all make mistakes, and we're all on a journey, which kind of like puts you, well, there's, who am I? But the Bible's very clear and it actually lists things in three of Paul's letters, and say, and it lists things, and that's one, just one of them. It says those who practice, notice practice, it's ingrained, okay? There hasn't been a break and a repentance of it. Those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. It's in Galatians, it's in Corinthians, and it's in Ephesians. Will not inherit the kingdom of God. And you think, well, what's grace? This works. It's all held in tension, because we'll come to that in a minute, because it's, we're all being sanctified. But there needs to have been a discernible break from sin in our lives. That is only a supernatural work of grace. But yet God holds us, holds people responsible to repent. I remember, like I mentioned, look, before I got saved, nobody preached the gospel to me. Just by reading the New Testament again and again and again. As a young, red-blooded young guy, right, normal young guy growing up, I knew beyond a shadow of a doubt for me to be a Christian meant that I would never sleep with a woman until I got married. That was a condition on me having eternal life, going to heaven and not going to hell. And part of me thought, well, you know, if I just accept Jesus, he'll work on my heart and help me along the way. And there's churches in this city that would just have you straight in the door and baptize you and tell you you're saved and assure you you're going to go to heaven. And that's, that idol's still there. And I knew, had I not surrendered that idol, and you know, you try and make deals with God. Okay, well, I become a Christian if you promise to give me a wife. You know, the condition came down to me being saved and having eternal life is me being celibate for the rest of my life. That's not salvation by works. That is idol on the throne. Like, you know, in the Old Testament story, Dagon, down, smashed to pieces. And Jesus said the rich man the same thing, didn't he? And yet, had he sold everything he had, God would have given him a better deal. And I thank God I surrender. God by his grace, and yet we're all responsible to repent. And praise God. So, in Paul's gospel proclamation of real faith in Christ, he talks about righteousness and self-control. So what's he talking about there? He's saying, really, real faith in Christ will produce recognizable real fruit. And this is to a governor who's probably on the surface a very moral man, but very unclean underneath. Real faith in Christ will produce recognizable real fruit. It will be a turning from sin towards righteousness and towards self-control, purity of life. I knew before, if I wanted to go to heaven, I thought, well, I can make a deal with God and I'll get in at the last minute when I'm old. And I knew that wouldn't happen. For me to go to heaven, I couldn't be a drunkard. I couldn't smoke cannabis. Oh, that's all works, no? It's the idols down, down, down. And so this is what Paul's saying to this guy. And the Bible says, if we have real saving faith, there's an evidence of works. And even if, take this one on grace, the grace teaching is, that's why I really recommend Michael Brown's book, Hyper Grace. Very, very good. In the summer of 2013, by the Spirit of God and just by intensely getting into the Bible, I really began to see that the message of grace, that is huge in the church today. And you've got a thick end of the wedge and a thin end of the wedge, but it's all the same wedge. At the thick end of the wedge is crazy stuff, how even in the end God's going to reconcile the devil to himself, right? And then you've got the whole Joseph Prince and all that, even Andrew Womack, it's all part of that wedge. And it's can be people in that wedge who are saved, and like Paul said, I rejoice that Christ is preached and people can get converted, but it's a wedge and it's full of error. And so the grace is like this. Well, if we're carnal and rebellious, the answer to that is just give them more grace. So just be more nice to them, and then they'll hopefully get it. Because God's goodness leads to repentance. Well, God's goodness is actually, in the context, is delayed wrath and delayed judgment. And so the more grace and the more grace that people get, but the word of God says that the grace of God that brings salvation, not the false grace of God, because Peter warned in his letters, he says, people are taking Paul's teaching and twisting it to their destruction, as they do the other scriptures. So it was happening back then. But Paul said in Titus, he said, for the grace of God, Titus 2:11, the grace of God that brings salvation, this is the real grace, has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously and godly in this present age. So the grace of God working in through the message of the gospel says, repent, deny ungodliness and worldly lusts, that we, and it's speaking to us, it's not saying a little suggestion, we should live righteously and godly in this present age. And with the reception of that, with that, well, you're God, and although I've got all these, you know, I've been saved out with this crazy lifestyle, Lord, I've done 20 years of drugs and fornication, and here I am in a Christian, and I've still got all these crazy desires, and I need deliverance from all that stuff. But you're God, you say it, and I repent, and I just accept it. That type of heart will receive that word and then receive the empowerment to obey it. That's grace. Okay. So this is what Paul's saying in his gospel message. There's going to be a righteousness and a self-control. It's going to be divinely empowered, but man is responsible to repent from the other stuff and turn towards it. And if there's real faith, there's an evidence of works. If grace is working, there's going to be evidence. And then he speaks to the guy about coming judgment. And do you know, whatever we face in this life, we may face ridicule for being Christians. If Islam, in 20 years' time, if we feel like we're in the minority and we're under the thumb, we know there's a coming judgment. Not that we're going to go, we're on the winning side. But we know, oh, this is just a drop in the bucket. And there's a coming judgment. And God's going to sort everything out. But he says, this guy, there's a coming judgment. And the Bible says, I love it when Paul commentates on this in John Stott's commentary on Corinthians, we're saved by grace, but the judgment, it's not a God's judgment. God's going to go, well, you've received me, you've received me, you said the prayer, you didn't say the prayer. There's no such thing as a sinner's prayer in the Bible. If you want to, I mean, we've had the time to unpack that. Romans 10, if you confess with your mouth and believe with your heart that Jesus Christ, Lord, and God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. But in the context of that, in Roman culture, you could believe anything you want as long as you burn incense to Caesar once a year. You know, you can be in any pagan religion, but to be a Christian, yes, we'll honour Caesar, but Jesus is my Lord, not Caesar. Caesar's not risen from the dead, he's just a man. Jesus is my Caesar, which meant, you know, that's the context of it. But we take from that and make a quick formula, and because someone said a prayer, they're not now they're saved. And come on, it breaks your heart, and we're not judging people, because the spiritual man judges all things. We're very afraid to be wise and to make spiritual judgment. There's two different words for judgment. One is to scorn, one is to be mature. The word krino and anakrino. So you've been around, it's like, oh, I heard you accepted Jesus, and you know inside, that's not happening, man. There's no transformation, there's no change, there's been no repentance, and part of it, as the church, we're going to have to be willing to suffer. Paul said, I fill up in my flesh to the afflictions of Christ for the sake of the gospel. I endure all things for the sake of the elect. Do you know there's people in the gay community that are elected to eternal life? There's Muslims that are elected to eternal life in this city. And it's not a game of fate. Someone's going to have to go in there and love them enough to tell them the truth. And yes, pray for them and give them words of knowledge, but not this stupid. I seen it, you know, I saw the Holy Ghost movie, you know. Hey man, you're awesome. just going up to and save people and grow, pretending to grow the leg out. And you know, I do miracles, right? But I also know that there's a lot of stuff out there playing the game. If you want to, you can play the game. I've seen it. I've been in churches where they play the game, and they can make it look like it's not. And you can tell everyone they're all sinning. Give them these prophetic destiny words that are just pants. I just see some creativity over you, man. Where on earth does anyone read the Bible? Do you know what it's rooted in? It's not rooted in love. Well, we just want to love people. It's rooted in self-love, because I don't want to deny myself and become all things to these people. The fact that some of them are going to love me and receive Jesus, and some of them are going to hate me. Some of them might want to kill me. And maybe I may, maybe, just maybe, do you know what the greatest hindrance to us as a church in this land? We conform to the world and we feel oppressed by them. If we were to stop conforming and yes, suffering it, we'd feel totally free. Because the radical Muslims, they're willing to pay the price. Of course, a certain measure of respect, they're obeying their God. If I lived in Old Testament times, and there's Joshua, he's the gaffer, right? And we're following Yahweh, and Yahweh says, you're going to go in there and kill every man, woman and child. You're going to do as you're told. You've got to do it. Because I'm following my God, and he's the real God. Do you know what I mean? So how can you say, that's the truth? We're just living a different dispensation now, and so we don't fight us that way. But they're following their God, and they're prepared to go to prison. They're prepared to die, and they'll go to hell. And we, the church in the West, it's all self, it loves the world. And there's a day coming, God's going to get us out of it. And praise God for it. But yeah, Paul talked about judgment. This is, you know, and this is what the Bible says about one of the things about judgment. It says in 2 Corinthians 5, 10 and 11, it says, knowing therefore the terror of the Lord. There's a good seeker-sensitive message. See, this is Bible Christianity. This is why, just take all your Christian books or tape series, put them in a box and leave them for a month and just have Bible, biblical Christianity. Get that John Stott Romans thing that gets you in the text. He says, knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. I want to get into people's consciences. We are well known to God, and I also trust well known to your consciences. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things done in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. That's to everybody, Christian and non-Christian. So all of our salvation, if a person's really saved, the only evidence on judgment day to show it is what we've done in the body. So that just blows out all the stuff that's the ministry stuff. Why it's created? It's created for Christian media. You can only really get the truth, really, when we take this really seriously. And really, when our heart comes before it. And that's, people say, oh, we don't have a relationship with the Bible. We have a relationship with the Spirit, but he's the Spirit of truth. And this is, if you want to flow in the supernatural and miracles, this is the key to it as well. Okay. And yet, you know, when we talk about repentance and these things, I don't know about you, I get intimidated. I think, how on earth can anyone get I mean, look, how are you? You see how bad people are? You know, some of the people we work with and know in our family, to think. I've been having this dream, recurring dreams about one of my uncles. He's like the black sheep of the family. He's a bad guy. He's a really, really deeply sinful guy. I can't imagine him transformed, holy, reverent, praising God, no longer every curse word coming out of his mouth. Only God can do that. Which all brings it back to, it's God, and it's an effectual calling of God. But for the Spirit to move, The Spirit can only move through the truth. And so for us, I mean, this is like, wow, first session, isn't it, you know? But if we're going to be labourers in these last days and in a ministry like this, just, there's a lot to get in there. I've recorded it, you can get it again. But like I said, follow on from this. Get into the book of Romans. Okay, get into it verse by verse. Start studying it. You might have missed it before. The Message of Romans by John Stott. You can get it on Amazon. I'll send out the links tomorrow. And begin this year, just get that in you. You'll get a burden for the, we'll together get a burden for the gospel, because this is only something supernatural. Only the supernatural can do this. And this is the, we love miracles, we love faith, we love all that. But the greatest miracle of all is truly transformed people. We can't do that. We cannot. We're powerless. We can't say, well, we've seen so many people saved this year and so many people we baptized up. Sure. Joe, we can't do it. All we can do is avail ourselves before God, be faithful to do the work and to preach the right message in wisdom. And the rest is up to God. And if God decided to add two people, two converted people, that's up to God. If he decided what, 200 converted people, it's up to God. 2,000, it's up to God. But I believe he's got a good plan, because I believe we're all sober minded people that want to give ourselves to wisdom, give ourselves to prayer and the Holy Spirit. Praise God. And like I says, I believe in, definitely finish now, that in the future I just have a sense there's going to be revival. But after revival comes judgment, comes persecution. It always has been that case. And I personally want to invest myself in people in case I'm not around, because I'm not going to compromise the gospel. I'll go to prison. I'm not very brave. I'm not very good at being beaten up personally. I've said to God before, I've said things like, well, I want to be around long enough to see my children in adulthood. Even my dad recently said, well, we really worry about you when you've been ministering in Africa, because we know if Muslims got their hands on you, you wouldn't deny Jesus. And I went, no, I wouldn't. They'd cut me head off before I deny Jesus. I'm not for sale. And so that's the reality of it. That's a world away, isn't it, from the pop gospel. You know, it's a pop gospel. And yet Paul said, I rejoice Christ has been preached. There will be some get saved. But the nearer we're getting to the end and the separation's happening and the falling away, we've got to come into the truth. Amen. Praise God. Mm-hmm. Not be led by wolves and by false prophets and false teachers. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Father, we give glory to you, because it's such an awesome privilege, you know, to receive. Let's just receive the burden and the commissioning for the gospel. This isn't something that's just a 5-minute thing, you know. This is going to be, if it's like the commissioning for the gospel, to be entrusted with the gospel. It's good news in that back then all the pagan religions offered was all this like stuff, and this is this gospel, and it's grace and it's free, and yet man's sinfulness and rebellion has to be dethroned, and only God can do it. Has to be an absolute miracle. So Lord, we commit ourselves, we just surrender and receive the commission of the gospel. And even tonight I'm thinking, goodness me, have we done justice to it? But this is just the beginning. This is just the beginning. If just this year, there's lots of things we might look at, like mentoring, and that will include the gospel and supernatural evangelism, all kinds of things we might look at in group in dynamics for beginning to lead a small group. But if we all get a burden for the gospel, it's going to set us up for the rest of our lives. And this is not a 5-minute thing. This could take the next 20 years of some of our lives to really work this out. probably haven't got that long, but there you go. But Lord, this is a weighty thing. This is more important than any other enterprise on the planet to receive. That what the Book of Jude called to receive and contend for the faith once entrusted to the saints, and to kiss goodbye to our lives, to sign our life away at home. And in the year when I started going to Africa back in 2011, I left Fiona and the little kids and pregnant with Zoe. We wrote a check out together, signing our lives away to God, come what may. And it's like we all have to do that. We all have to choose. There's that little niggle inside, the what if. The what if I obey God? What if I fully let go? And the enemy will whisper all the things that will happen to you if you obey God. And this isn't a life where we're going to be foolish and just throw ourselves into, you know. But we have to let go of that, because it's a root of self-love. And in if that's not surrendered, that is the very thing that could actually destroy us. By letting go of it, by letting go of fear and self-love, whether it's for us or ourselves or even our children, we give ourselves into the hands of God, and there's no safer place to be than in His will. 100% surrender to Him. And the heart is deceitful above all things, and there's so many blessings in the gospel, there really is, and thank God for them. And but we avoid this crucible. It's the human will. Only God can conquer it, and yet somehow we're responsible for surrendering it. And it's the crucible. It's the very thing. And it is self-love. The love of self, which is the message of the age that we live in. And tragically, it's the message of much of the church. The message of self-love. So we must surrender. If we try and save our life, we will lose our life. If we lose our life for His sake, we will gain it. Jesus said, whoever leaves father, mother, wives and children, and it's like in your heart, even all the securities of life, all those little ties that tie you. And you know, the Bible talks about we've got to be responsible for our families, and there's tensions and there's balances, but in our heart of hearts, every mooring line that needs to be cut is cut. I'm surrendered, because Jesus says, then I will give you houses and lands and persecutions, and in the world to come eternal life. And the vision that God will give us, will walk in a level of God. There's a last days church God is raising up that's going to walk in a level of the anointing that's not been seen since Acts. But Jesus lasted 3 years in the anointing before they killed Him. So this anointing is going to be wonderful. It's going to be awesome. But sooner or later, it's going to be a face-to-face encounter and confrontation with this world spirit. This is the gospel. It's awesome, guys. It's awesome. Jesus, we just love you. We worship you. We give you our life, Lord. We give you our life. We trust you for our future. Hallelujah. We trust you for our future. Just let go of the world, because we want to see souls won. Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Let the fear go. Let the fear go. Fear's from the devil. It's a lie. How much more will the Father feed and clothe you? Let the fear go. The church is full of fear in this land. It's full of fear. Full of... He says, yeah, I clothe the grass of the field. I feed the birds of the air. How much more are you worth to me than those? And you know, all the days ordained for us are written in his book before any of them come into being. And no man and no devil, once we put ourselves in the will of God, no man and no devil can shorten any of those days to the last second. No devil can touch your kids. When you put, we'll put ourselves completely in his will for the kingdom, because this is what this is about. It's for the kingdom. It's not just, well, part of these house groups and see where this goes. God wants movement, souls won, saved, wants people in this room that you reach into your destiny, what you're called to be. But it does mean a surrender. But it's worth it. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. I wrestled with God once. I was planning to get life insurance before one of my ministry trips. I was in touch with the insurance guys. God had me over the table on that one, said I had to let it go. I'm not saying that you shouldn't have life insurance. If for me, God's told me I'm not to have it. I don't have a career. I don't have a mortgage. I don't have anything in the world. We left a church 6 years ago, having not built any foundation in the world, hadn't got on the property ladder, anything like that. We rent our home, we've been blessed where we live. And so you think, naturally, I want to get established in life. I want all this. And I believe God's going to prosper. Amen, amen. And I think, well, if I really start obeying God, what happens if something happened? I want to make sure I have my wife and kids, naturally. And God nailed me. And I just remember the day when I emailed the insurance rep and I emailed Psalm 91. Copy and pasted Psalm 91 into that email, told them I'd found a better policy. A much better policy, and here's the terms of it. And I'd say, well, what happens if the devil hears you talk like that? The devil needs to hear me talk like that. And when I click the send button, the die is cast. And it's so, sign it away. Whatever it is, sign it away. Let it go. Praise God. Amen. Glory. So that was it's 20 to 10. 10 minutes over. I don't know what we'll do next time, but I just felt that was the Lord just wanting to bring a real foundational introduction. Hope that's blessed you.